spend this beautiful day talking about psychopaths and sociopaths in leadership roles.
I've been working with the clinical psychological approach to leadership since 92, and there's always been this talk about psychopaths and sociopaths in organizations, and it had my special interest. Do we really see so many psychopaths out there? And what is the impact they have on organizations? In 2012, I started studying forensic emotional awareness and micro-expressions to see if I could better spot the psychopath. This chapter is about psychopaths and sociopaths and the impact I believe they have on organizations.
Let's dive into psychopath and sociopath and how they work in the daily life and how they function in the role as managers. I hope you enjoyed the start, because that was actually a part of the movie that I'm making, where one of the chapters is also about psychopathy and sociopath. So I hope you enjoyed that. Before we dive into all this about psychopath and sociopath and so on, I would like to shout out a big thank you for all of you who have raised the flag saying this is what we believe about the last vlog, and this is our thoughts about you bringing Logan Paul into the game. And thank you so much for sharing that with me. Also, thanks to all of you who have sent in your thoughts about leadership philosophies that you think I should look at. Some of them I had looked at, some of them I'm gonna look at, and thank you very much for that. But let's dive into psychopath and sociopath. And there's something here that's missing. There's something here I find is wrong. And one of them is that we talk about it as it's the same, and then it's not the same. And then we have some criteria saying that we don't have psychopath anymore. Now it's only personality disorders. And then we have somebody saying we have sociopath and we have psychopath. It's very confusing and it's very difficult to understand. And there are, in general, two ways of putting people, diagnosing people with any kind of mental disorder. And that is within the DSM-5 or the IDC-10. And I'm not going to go into details what they say and why they say what they say. But I would like to share with you that there are differences in how they look at it. And therefore, you can also find differences in what people are saying out there on the internet and what kind of research that you can bring up, that you can read. And there's a lot of very good research out there that's definitely worth reading, but there's also a lot of crappy research. And so in general, the measurements are that 3% of the population has traits going towards being sociopaths, and 1% have traits going towards being a psychopath. And then there are other measurements saying, so if you go into, as you go up in the hierarchy in organizations, you will see that at the top of top executive, the part of people being sociopath / psychopath is grown to around 23 to 25%. I think that's an extremely high number, and I'm not sure how that is measured. I'm not sure whether we can take that for granted or not. And I would like for us to kind of like call a timeout saying, let's be careful with throwing diagnoses of psychopaths and sociopaths out there as we just want to do it. Because there's a lot of things that could be different than what we think we see. And the reason I'm saying this is that I feel that a lot of, as well psychologists as a lot of others, they throw around with the term of psychopath and sociopath and people with personality disorders, whether it being borderline or histrionic or whatever. And it's more complicated to diagnose than just like that. And that's why we should be careful about doing that. And in the media, on YouTube, you can find a lot of small TV shows saying that if you have these 10 traits, you are a sociopath. Or if your manager has these 10 traits, he's definitely a psychopath, and so on and so on. And I'm not sure that it's that simple. I know for sure it's not that simple. There's a lot of other stuff to it. It's not just that if people have sleep less at night, now they're a psychopath. Or if people are very rigid, they are psychopath. That's not how it works. Or if people behave badly, they're a psychopath. That's not how it works. So I'd like for us to be careful about doing that. It might be that we have a manager who has bad behavior, who has behavior that we find absolutely ridiculous, absolutely out of norm, out of proportion. But it's not the same as him being a sociopath or a psychopath. It could be that he just has a high degree of inner fear of not being good enough, and therefore he creates what we can call allowing thoughts about why can I behave like I do. It's kind of like the same thing sociopaths do. They have allowing thoughts. They're saying, I can do this and that. I can manipulate like this and that. I know that's what I'm doing, but it's okay because whatever reasons they have. They create excuses for themselves to do what they have to do. And we all do that. We all have these traits. Think about the carpenter who goes to work and he uses nails every day and he has a hammer put in. And one day he's at home, he has his company car with him home with all the material. And one day he needs a nail. He will go and grab a nail in the company car and use it at home. So now he's actually a thief. But he's not really a thief. He's just found an allowing thought saying, okay, that might be okay just to take this one. Now this is looking at it from a small perspective. But that is how it changes. And look at the way that when you grow up through the career, different views change. And suddenly, this is very interesting. Suddenly you become the manager who needs to lead the company, taking the big decisions, being kind of like, you have to dare greatly sometimes, believing in your own belief, believing in that you're doing the right stuff. And that is threatening, also towards your threat system. So that could be one of the reasons that managers turn down their vulnerability, their capability. The vulnerability, well, meaning their capability of looking at their own beliefs could be wrong and something else could be right. Having that kind of like flexibility, it doesn't happen. We see that as people grow in hierarchies, they become more and more rigid. And there are good reasons, but it's not the same as they becoming sociopath or psychopath. So differing a lot between focusing on just diagnosing psychopath and sociopath and not accepting it could be something else. It could be them turning down vulnerability because they have an inner fear of not being good enough, having an inner fear of knowing that they're actually not good enough and fearing to show it so other people can see it, knowing that they need to have this big burden on their shoulders saying, if I fail, lots of people will lose their jobs, a lot of families will lose their income to pay. It's a big, big, big responsibility. And sometimes it's just better for us to kind of like push it a bit away, close down the vulnerability so we don't go with all that fear and anxiety constantly. But again, not the same as being a psychopath. So do we have sociopaths and psychopaths in organizations? Yes, we do. Definitely. And do I believe, because I don't know for sure, but do I believe that the amount will grow as we grow in the organization? Yes, I do believe that. But still, I also believe that a lot of them that we believe have these traits, and they have the traits, they're not clinical sociopaths. They're not somebody that we can clinically say that they're way off, they're a sociopath, they're a psychopath. It could just be that they have increased, we all have the traits, and they have increased the use of those traits, and therefore they can seem a bit out of order in what the normal norms are. My big thing is just be aware, don't throw around these terms. Because if we think about what a psychopath is, a psychopath is someone who has a pleasure in some way of putting pain and suffering on others. We know them from these guys like Ted Bundy and Ed Campbell and so on. And if you look at the one in your organization that you're saying he might be a psychopath, do you see him as one of these guys doing what they've done? And if you listen to some of the interviews, I can recommend you to go and listen to some of the interviews that you can find on YouTube with these mass murderers, psychopaths, and you will see that they have definitely bad traits, and it's not in the same level as the one that you see in your organization. But we also see that people become greedy and thereby their sociopathic and psychopathy traits become very clear is when they start to take money out and become more greedy. They have high risk profiles. They're willing to do this and that, and they're willing to do whatever it takes to get more for themselves. And they have good reasons why that is okay. And without putting it out there saying, I know for sure these guys are, but you have to look at some of the big companies where it has been fraud all the way through. Look at Murdoch. Can we say that he is a psychopath? I can't. I would never be capable of diagnosing him because I don't know him. But some of the things he has done is without mentalizing, without having other people's mind at heart, without thinking about how it could harm others. And these are some of the traits that is wrong. And these are some of the traits that we see in psychopathy and in sociopaths. It's that they don't have the moral compass saying, so what is going on in the others? Is that okay? They don't feel that. They don't recognize that. They don't really care about it. So these are some of the things that I would like to share with you in terms of psychopathy and sociopaths in organization. Some of you might say, but Michael, what about narcissism? Isn't that a part of this? And yes, it is. No, it isn't. I've left it out today. I might do another vlog talking about narcissism because that also have a lot of interesting traits. There's also a lot of that is interesting, especially in order to organization. I just think that it's more interesting than psychopath and sociopath in organizations because I believe that narcissism is an even bigger problem than sociopath and psychopaths in organizations. But more about that in another vlog. And much more about this topic and how it works when we look in the books, in the movie that is coming out in the late 2018. Thank you for watching. If you found this interesting, please share it with the rest of the world. Push that like button, subscribe if you haven't already. And I'm looking forward to seeing you in the next vlog.